I'm here with this fourth band. You got to wonder if that Underlord is in their mind. It's to the ESF that they take out something that had a very good game against them in the mid lane early in the series when we was playing the OD.
So, do we see the Underlord, the Witch Doctor? What do we see here?
Witch Doctor is very possible since the SD is good at disabling illusions, but right now they're slightly lacking strong disables. Sand King's a good start. Disruptor would have been a great follow-up. And the fact that they banned Shadow Fiend makes me feel that DC is going to be a little burst heavy with their picks here, since BKB SF is very problematic sometimes. Basically, any hero that buys BKB, very likely for newbie. They could even go for a Jug pick here. Although, Jug and Luna on the same team might be a bit iffy. Even like Ogre could be solid. Omni Knights didn't get banned this game, by the way. So we could see an Omni on DC as well.
Yep.
You like Darkseer at all?
Kind of, but not a huge amount. I guess with Morana, I don't really see it as super synergy there.
Oh, more for Neepy.
Okay.
It's in since game one, but Lifestealer still there.
I feel like they need a mech carrier.
Yeah, I really like the Lifestealer idea, actually.
Okay, they're going to go back for the Witch Doctor. That's game number four in a row now.
Yep, same old, that third pick Witch.
Yep. It's been third pick all the time as well.
I think you're pretty correct about the lifesteal possibility for a newbie, though, just because Shadow Demon Disruption Arrow, you want somebody that can have a free BKB, and he can work in that way. Really? At least for early roaming, he'll be effective. It makes me think of an Ursa in prep for DC, although they don't know who the enemy mid is, so it's maybe definitely a little too early for that.
I mean, do you feel DC could go slot our lifestealer?
It's pretty good with Morana, I guess. They could do arrow setups. And it's like, I don't know why we haven't just picked Darkseer yet. I'm telling you guys.
Okay.
Turn to pick.
That's good too.
Yeah, the Centaur has been seen. Not in this grand final, but we have seen it throughout the tournament. Used sporadically, but used very well.
I like him versus the mass magic damage lineup too. Like him getting a hood, and he has a magic resistance talent, the 10%. It's incredibly good. I think it's much better if you want to team fight against magic damage as opposed to the Underlord, who's much better against the physical.
Do you feel like newbie should grab Slaughter here? No, because they have pretty good damage outputs of many different types, but they need something that's a bit better catch. I feel like he could kind of cover a similar role as Sanking. Maybe it's a mistake to have both on the same team, but...
Maybe Silencer, actually, I think. Might be good for them. I think, like, the one of the problems with the Slaughter is, like, they have the SD save, which
is... They're gonna go over this time.
Ogre.
At least Luna will be able to amp a lot better with Bloodlust. Much faster farming, better damage in teamfights. And Ogre Magi, obviously, lane pressure is a big thing, too. Remaining. So it kind of makes up for the fact that Witch Doctor's a little bit vulnerable, I think. Because they're going to have to lane against the Centaur, and very possibly it could be a dual lane. I think this would be a great game, actually, for Undying. This looks like an Undying game to me.
For DC?
Yeah, I think so. That plus Centaur. Maybe their disable's weak, but if Morana's the other support... No, I guess I can't.
Cause versus the Luna, right. Though. Glaive's kind of wreck.
Do they bounce from zombie and kill him? Okay, yeah, maybe don't pick it then.
10 seconds remaining.
But I feel like pairing something with the center is kind of important.
Well, newbies turn. We talked about it in terms of potentially newbie picking up, but actually,
that's
the other side.
I like that a lot, honestly, because as long as Lifestealer gets a delivery mechanism, he's gonna kill one hero. Probably Witch Doctor, could be Ogre as well.
They need a save, actually.
On whose side?
Newbies. Yeah, I think the Luna just seems like she could just get bum rushed.
Yeah, that's what it feels like. That's why I'm a little surprised about the Ogre. I feel like I kind of feel like Lifestealer would have worked better for a newbie, maybe.
They can always go back to OD unless it gets banned out right now. Sniper ban.
Is that even going to be survivable enough?
I think it's good enough to protect the Luna. I think the Luna's the one you're worried about the most, just because she seems super super fragile. I think OD. I think he also works well with the Bloodlust.
She's banning out the Ember, so. Yeah. The Ogre. Oh, sorry, the OD is still ready for the taking.
I actually like
that. So they ban the Ember and they take what?
Not sure. They had to go Ember though, because the catch on newbie is still a bit weak.
Oh.
This justifies it completely.
Okay, we're gonna get bumped.
They have such good gap close and burst damage in so many different forms too. They can disrupt somebody, land an arrow. They can do center stun. They can do Like Steal has so many delivery mechanisms. As soon as he's six, Quap can go somewhere and get a kill.
Could this be a game where they slip for the SCCTA?
I don't know if that's so good against Quap.
Or do you still prefer the OD idea?
I still like
it. Ah, yes. Oh. I love it.
Okay.
A bit of action from SCCC. He's a showman on this hero. But so's we on the Quap.
Absolutely. This is going to be a fantastic fifth and final game. Ladies and gentlemen, hold on to your seats because game 5 of 5 is about to begin. Let's go back to our commentary team. Capitalist and Toby Wan, it's all yours.
This started as a 3-day event, and as we have now crossed over midnight, we can say you got a bonus. You got the 4th day Digital Chaos going up against Newbie. It all comes down to this Capitalist, and what a run it's been.
It's been an amazing series so far. A game 5. I don't actually know where to call this draft, and I think that's probably for the best at this point. You actually, Toby, you said Templar Assassin last pick for Newbie, and when you said it, I was like, I'm with you. TA's good versus Lifestealer. It's probably one of the better matchups against Mirana as well. It can deal with the Shatter Demon gank somewhat. And I also think the Queen of Pain was a strong last pick for Digital Chaos. It's a carrier, it's a vehicle for that Lifestealer. It's a nice, aggressive tempo controller. DC are definitely going to be playing very, very fast this game. And Newbie are going to be a little bit slower. They have both the TA and the Luna, who needs some farm buildup, and the Sand King, who also needs his Blink Dagger. DC have this Centaur ultimate that gets for, you know, he just gets level 6. He doesn't actually need something there. The Queen of Pain operates as an early vehicle for the Lifestealer, so Lifestealer can actually start being an active ganking force really whenever he wants to. So it's possible that DC can start running over Newbie before they get their basic items needed for team fights.
Man, you're getting me even more excited for the start of this game, just to see how Newbie's going to deal with DC's early aggression, and maybe just how well DC are able to implement that aggression. But personally, it's enough hype to get me through the rest of that, because I want to give a big shout out as well to everyone who is tuning in online, be it in Malaysian TV, be it online at all the streaming platforms, or be it the guys who are still here till the end of the night. You guys have been one of the best crowds we've had in Dota. The Arena of Stars being lit up with you guys, and make a hell of a lot of noise going into this last game. The teams will need it too. It has been a very long day. DZ started it off. Newbie are now playing their 8th game in a row. This is also turning in to a day of stamina for both these teams to get the final game. All the competition, it all boils down to this one matchup, DC versus Newbie. Who's going to get the start? How's it all going to unfold? We find out now as the lanes will meet.
We're going to see in the mid lane, Kaka's going to be playing the Ogre Magi, babysitting his Templar Assassin, doing the typical dumb ogre things. He's going to just be running at Weehaw, and Weehaw's going to go, what the hell do I do about this? He turns around, he throws out a Shadow Strike and does some right clicks, but Kaka is also going to throw that damage over time spell. So yep. This is just going to ensure that SC gets an okay start in the first level or two, and then he'll bounce out pretty quickly. KP on the Sand King offlane is going to have a pretty rough time whenever Soxa and Misery are actually here, but they should be looking to rotate out of this lane sometime, and KP will find his openings eventually.
I'm loving this start that comes out from Faith. Like, it's like, yes, like, let's just bypass the ability which we said was close to being an ultimate paralyzing cast. It goes to the first point up in Maledict. It's the only way he can get that harassment up against Moon, but then Moon answers back with getting return at level 1. So it's almost just like a slog fest where both players just accept the fact they're going to hurt each other.
I mean, Moon's happy. He sees the lane is pushing forward. He's like, as long as they don't get this pull off, I'm very happy. But Kaka, he does make the rotation from mid, tries to get both the range creeps over there, but it doesn't quite work. Moon Meander, his next creep wave comes in, and Newbie are going to have to try again. They really don't want to let Moon Meander be in experience range for these 3 range creeps, one of which has already died.
Man, did Return actually just help him then to pull the creep wave back over when Kaka attacked?
Huh? Yeah. He's routinely trying to right-click these heroes and pull the creep wave for
KP,
himself.
KP, that's his Barrow Strike. He's going to sit in Sandstorm. Misery has the arrow. He actually baited it, so KP would move off the mark. He doesn't have to waste the mana. But he also doesn't find the stun. He would have missed it anyway, because he didn't know where KP would move.
We are baiting out the Shadow Strike there, but
he's got no mana for Blink.
He just goes straight for the meld, and it's not even necessarily to dodge the Shadow Strike. He just uses the meld to fully be back.
Oh, no room for you, Moon.
SC's score looking pretty good, 9-4 compared to 7-3.
Yeah, normally you could say this lane would favor Wii a little bit more just because she can't keep the defensive refraction charges up. And until you have a dire sentry ward controlling the mid, Meld can be dodging that Shadow Strike. So you put 2 points up into that, 1 point in Blink, no points up in the Scream. You're just not... Well, you're not going to find the commitment you're really searching for. This one will connect just because there's no mana on the Templar Assassin.
And that's... Well, it's actually not going to be fixed right away. He's actually going to be going for the boots first, but he'll also shrine up. Weeha was already forced to shrine, so they're even now. Moonmander may take too much damage
with the paralyzing cast, give it bounces back up again. There will be enough damage with the Malindic. First blood spilled by Newbie, really forcing the issue against a very tanky offlaner of Centaur. Even under his T1 tower, he had the bonus armor.
Yeah, the supports of Digital Chaos are just a bit too late to rotate and see if they can get some sort of punishing trade-off. That is the thing, is that they're going to rotate out, and then KP's going to feel a little bit more free to sit in lane. What the supports wanted to do is establish just enough control that Lifestealer gets a 1 or 2 level lead on the Sand King, and then he won't be bothered. He has, like, enough, especially if he gets the early phase boots, he has enough to zone KP by himself.
He knows he's fine. He knows he's fine. Thanks to that Observer Ward that's sitting just a little bit north of the mid lane, he saw the rotation of the SD. Didn't see the Mirana as well behind, but it was just enough that the Ogre of Kaka was able to just to give enough support that he felt safe.
Here comes the smoke. DC, very important here that they get a successful rotation into the offlane to allow Moonmander. Because Moonmander is playing this hero that is easily punished, but is also a strong offensive hero if the supports can find the right opening. And they're going to get it too. This wraparound looks really good for them.
But the Ogre has also arrived. So the numbers are 3-on-3 disruption. Into the arrow, connect on the Luna. The Paralyzing Cask and Maledict Centaur can still get off the Hoof Stomp. And now it's up to Misery. A bit of a body block might creak time, but no. They've already got what they were looking for.
Look at this. Mid lane, KP is actually, despite he knows he has this 1v1, especially with the supports now showing themselves at bottom, he tries to rotate onto Wii, and
we
this may be the perfect time.
We knew all about this. He had an Observer Ward. He knew SK was behind, but because he's done so much damage to the TA, there's just no way they could find the kill on Weeha. He dealt with the situation before it even happened.
Yeah, CS just wasn't quite good enough for him to be able to get the bottle by now, and he has to run all the way back to base. That's a pretty rough slowdown. He has to actually spend some of his money now. Instead, he's going to buy up the Ring of Aquila and a TP scroll, head back to lane and see if he can challenge Weeha some more. But Weeha and Moonmander have both been showing a lot of strength in the laning phase. It's been a big advantage for them to be able to set themselves off on the right foot. KP, meanwhile, has been playing a Sandstorm game against Resolution.
He is okay. Well, I was waiting for him to say he's in trouble, but Misery didn't look to combo the arrow. They probably didn't have enough damage anyway, so Misery uses the arrow to farm instead.
The range creep was also in the way. I think SC knew that the Mirana was on the right-hand side behind him, so he positioned himself where the range creep would most likely be a problem for the Mirana to work around. But you're also right, they didn't have the damage. Much better for Misery to use this mana.
Spoil that shot.
Continue to build up levels for himself.
Yeah, he's gonna be a lot happier with the start of this game compared to his bounty hunter game before. Even if it's not like heavy influence, you still know that this Mirana is able to get a lot of farm just with the way the mechanic arrow works, that instant kill onto the neutrals.
An illusion rune, but that is going to be spotted off by SC, so he sees that Sox was trying to make a rotation into mid lane, trying to catch Templar Assassin, despite the fact that Misery was actually bottom. So that trap does provide quite the saving grace. He may not have expected that kind of solo rotation.
Misery's got to be careful. There's another Lucid Beam. That's a level 3. Combining up with the stun and the Ignite, he'll leap away. Paralyzing Cast will follow him. The damage is enough. That's a level 2 Ignite burn on the Mirana, and now maybe a little bit of disruption. U9 does have a little small path to get out of this, but more TP support is on the way. It's Resolution, open wounds. He wants the kill over on Luna, and he's gonna get it. Moon's already looking at the next target. He doesn't have his level 6 just yet. Makaka, TP out, and then checking the wrong side of the trees.
This Lifestealer's just gonna get so far ahead. He already had somewhat of a CS advantage over the Luna,
that
but now getting that kill.
SC with a leap, the Starfall, the damage, Sonic Waves above. SC still cops enough damage to die. They cancel the secondary TP in, and then just leave U9 to soak up the mid.
U9, he needs to be able to get some sort of... They've kept these supports at bottom lane so much because the Centaur is this constant threat and you want to be able to keep him out of experience range. But then they've also dealt with the aggression of the Shadow Demon and the Mirana rotating into this lane. So they've always had to soak a lot of the experience away from this Luna. So as a result, she's still not level 6, just a little bit shy.
Well, they're going to go again. Disruption? Not really. This is just under the tower causing SC some headaches. Resolution really wants to commit to this. Like, he actually has to wait for the melt to wear off, because they just don't have any reveal. So they need to bait the melt out of SC.
Kaka and KP. KP, I think they need Kaka to help him out. He needs to be able to find some more space. Because, again, I think the Blink Dagger is...
Oh, wow. This is just looking almost too easy. Resolution. Open wounds will now trigger. Paralyzing cast. There's still no rage being triggered by Resolution. Now he's going to do it. Chasing after U9. SC's right behind him. There's no melt for him. But you have the Moonlight Shadow up, so DC get in and out. And they're even using this time to get a nice aggressive Observer Ward planted in behind the T1 tower. So you know that's exactly where DC want to look for the next target. Over to Ogre in the tree lines. The blink in from Weeha, body blocking out Kaka. He can't just walk away, but Weeha's taking too much damage from the tower. Defensive disruption. There's a bias in space, but SC's already there. But Weeha, no, they went on the illusion. The paralyzing cast will bounce up. Will it come back down again? Weeha, 2 seconds, 1 second, no blink. He's away to the other side of the river.
Oh, the eclipse just got up
in misery with his leap away. He dodges the ulti of Luna.
Oh man, DC, they're playing this fast and they're not being punished by Newbie at all. Newbie just failed to be able to get both of those kills, and big time ultimates being used as well. Middle tower is
under attack. Oh boy.
This is pretty rough. Then again, we're expecting this, right? DC, yep. They're naturally going to be able to take, I think, a little bit more of a laning phase advantage. Their rotations are going to be stronger earlier on. Newbie, they know they're going to be very much exposed, especially as we start getting into that 15-minute marker, which is where I think the Sand King Blink Dagger is very important. The faster KP can get this, they can start punishing Digital Chaos's aggressive maneuvers around the map.
They need to have more space. When you got a Centaur running at you, you're still going to respect the level of damage that Moon can throw at you. And while he's doing that, he's also looking down to the bottom lane. Like, what do? Do you try and help him out? That tier 1 tower has been slowly chipped away by Resolution. We're 10 minutes in, but are you really wanting to commit to a fight? Weeha's keeping a lot of attention on the middle lane to try and also help out SC. There's a lot of open wounds that Newbie have to try and patch up.
Oh man, KP has actually chosen a 3-2-0-6 build. So he actually is going to be, he went for the epicenter because I think they thought with Kanka's rotation, if he hits the burrow strike and then the follow-up stun, he'd be able to get off the epicenter and maybe that'd be enough to kill Centaur, but Centaur already has 1200 HP and a cloak, and he knows about this rotation from Kaka thanks to their deep well ward that they have.
And they know about U9, they still know he doesn't have Eclipse available, so they bring in the SD. There's more support arriving in the form of Misery. All he's gonna do is just do a skimming arrow over the top of the tree line, and he's probably gonna find him, and actually now the Sentry Ward gets discovered. So they've lost that vision on the other side of the hill, but will they still find the arrow? It's only gonna take out the catapult.
They're practically touching.
Yep. So close. You could snip the Centaur's tail from this range with KP. Does he want a burrow strike in? 16 seconds until Eclipse is up, but Weeha with a double damage rune is still attacking into the mid tower. Resolution has taken out the bottom. Newbie, they want this fight, but they just can't have it. No matter how much you want it, you can't have it.
Newbie just gave up a mid tier one because of that.
They gave up two. They lost the bottom as well.
Yeah, that was...
And maybe now they even lose Kaka with the open wounds. Weeha with the double damage. If he needs to commit the Sonic Wave, he can also do so, but it's not really required. Kaka will fall. Resolution will claim it. But now in comes Faith. No rage available. They start with the Maledict. They don't really want to throw out the cast just yet, but you've got Moonlight Shadow. So Resolution hides in Invis.
Oh, no.
Where's your detection? It's open wounds onto U9. Rage is off cooldown. He's got Infest with a blink forward of Weeha. U9 is ticking out.
Wait,
so he'll be alive on 40 HP. They didn't finish the job. The Luna will be able to survive. Maybe with the arrow flying in, it's going to connect on Faith, but there's no follow-up to this. Weeha's a little bit too far away.
Man, Weeha has his Sonic Wave to Kaka.
Kaka, yeah, initiated on. There's a lot of Centaurs running his way. That's thanks to the SD, KP will arrive as well. They're being swarmed on. Misery's looking for another target. The arrow flies, KP gets
got him.
Fed! 5 seconds on the stun. Boo could follow up with a double edge. Maybe not. Kaka gets the stun KP. Burrow strikes back through two. Mystery still there to lend the damage, but now with the power of the cast bouncing around and the Death Ward. Moon, he's taking through most of this damage with the extra stun from Kaka. It may just be enough. Moon's head. Maybe with the hood he could do enough. Another arrow flying in, tanked by the creep wave.
Coming for the side, DC still trying to figure out if maybe they can get an initiation off of this invis rune from the lifestealer. See if he can pick apart one of the heroes as they separate.
Now he'll find SC, but they're really holding together, even triggering off the try. Misery, he has mana for another arrow.
Uh-oh, the category stop.
Now resolution, they started off. Where is this arrow? Misery flying it all the way down.
Oh,
and
got
it's 5 seconds on SC. But already resolution got the solo kill on Faith. He has no more mana to go for anything else.
Yeah, I like that. Misery is like, okay, it's a lifestealer on top of a support. There's no way that support doesn't die. So I'll just try and get the extra arrow, but a Templar Assassin that far back and the rest of DC were not really close to take advantage of that. So
it at least keeps Newbie from turning around and helping him.
Yeah, that top lane engagement, though, is pretty important that the multicast went down, because I think that extra bit of stun allowed the Burrow Strike to be able to go down, hits those two heroes, and even if he does die, right, it doesn't matter. He managed to make a worthwhile exchange because of that stun, because of that little bit of delay keeping DC from retreating fast enough.
Here comes DC, smoke gang down, they find a target, it's gonna be KP, quick fire strike away, but quick is not that fast when your open wound's done. Bleeding holes and you can't run as fast. Now Misery looking for that fishing arrow. He's not going to find anything, in fact, but they stampede forward and it's allowing Resolution to come in behind the tower. You've still got that little perch creep to help him out, but Newbie under the tier 2 tower. Is this really where DC want to fight? They put down the sentry ward, Newbie, so they know if DC will push in closer, and they'll see Resolution TPing out as well, so everyone's away.
I felt DC like on the cusp of disaster there. I was like, no, that's tier 2.
Well, they may lose another. Moon's coming back in again. You're gonna get the stun out from Kaka. Arrow flies fall, but it's a stray from Misery with a Death Ward. Moon will fall.
Yeah, that's pretty nasty, because they really want to get progress into the Blink Dagger on the Centaur too. And he was getting relatively close. He still has the 1100 gold after that death.
Now, we'll all have a moment just to think about things. Notice too that build coming out from Weeha. Was actually wondering how he's going to approach his build. We've seen the Blade Mouse, we've seen that kind of approach from the co-op. He's actually going directly into Aghanim Scepter on this Queen of Pain.
Yeah, I actually mentioned this one to Blitz. I felt like the Aghanim Scepter, in my experience, the Aghanim Scepter just feels like a very solid, consistent build for Queen of Pains right now. Because the Aghanim Scepter allows you to be able to have this really low cooldown. You're able to just blow ultimates to push through waves. And this will speed up your farm and naturally your experience as well. So we're talking about a Queen of Pain that is more late game oriented. So as such, this farming tool of the Aghanim Scepter, I think, is really quite good. These earlier blade mails and such, I think they're very much hit or miss. I think the same goes with the Orchid. You're naturally going to build into the Orchid later on, absolutely. But I think the Axe kind of serves as making sure the Queen of Pain will absolutely hit certain timings going 25 and 35 minutes.
Yeah. And even that combination which you look for with the Octarine blade mail and her extra talent buff up, like, you can still build into this later, so it's fine. Echo Saber is now completed over on the Lifestealer, and his next target will be into the Assault Cuirass for Digital Chaos.
No Tessellator.
Yeah, not even just the casual Blight. That's what I was wondering before, like, Resolution was slowly chipping away at those towers. If he just had a little bit more negative armor to help you, maybe that would have been faster.
Oh, did he not have it earlier?
Nope. Oh, he's actually completely... Unless I saw him pick it up and then... Oh, didn't see him pick it up and then sell it.
See, KP has 1,200 gold, so he's hitting about the same when it comes to the Centaur.
Oh, that crowd.
Hey, there's a lot of fans on both sides right here, all right?
Maybe online, but not in this venue, apparently.
We're a very welcoming group. I think there may actually be more just Weeha fans alone than any other fans in this crowd.
Weeha certainly found his region, man.
Yeah, he really did. He really did. Hello, Malaysia. Welcome to Weeha.
They recognize Steel. Templar Assassin, SC, is actually also going up Blink Dagger in his quick buy. I think they need ways to be able to combat this... this aggressive playstyle of DC. They've already bled away all their outer tier 1 towers, and I think that's a step that Newbie really did not want to have to take, I think they made such an error when they attempted that five-man push up in the top lane. And of course, like, DC already knew about it because of their aggressive ward. They saw some of these rotations coming in play, so they just played really defensively around their tier one and let their other two cores, the Lifestealer and the Quap, push in. They lost two outer towers because of that one. The mid tower in particular, I felt, was quite a blow for Newbie. And because of that, I think Newbie has to struggle really hard to pick up these early game items that let them contest DC, because they can't afford to lose tier 2s this early on to the game.
At the same time, you could also just put it down to the fact that SC has so much confidence in his Templar Assassin. We saw him actually go this a very similar build earlier on in the tournament, because he's just so aggressive and believes he can find these kills with the TA.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, he's proven time after time that some of these more mobile heroes, that he's able to abuse positioning really well. His Templar Assassin and Queen of Pain stand out for that exact reason.
And if they can get both those Fling Daggers up, KP as well as SC are just going to go ham and create more space for the Luna. A hero which we've seen mainly bring games back. I think MP is probably going to be the best example you can look at for that one. You feel behind, you get a little bit of farm up on the Luna, you just need one really good fight where the Luna has space and just continues to attack, and things really start to turn around, because you push back really hard if she can survive.
They're keeping this aggressive push by Resolution in bottom lane, and it seems like they think that maybe Newbie will rotate and try and catch Resolution, maybe with the Sand King initiating off the Burrow Strike, but Sand King showed himself at top lane, still trying to farm that Blink Dagger.
It's the Newbie's turn to smoke up. They're pretty grouped up around that top bounty rune, but their tier 2 tower is already falling. They've got fortification, so they can buy some time, and that's exactly what they do. But you look at the filters. Like, it's Misery and Moon running around the mid. They break the smoke over on Karga, and Misery gonna get stunned. The arrow will fly astray. SC, no quick way to get in. Resolution, they've already TP'd over the shrine. SC jumps in, instantly pops off Misery, so you don't have him for the fight. Maybe with that Death Ward in the backline too. Facing him, best ball bound. Resolution trying something about it, but the Sonic Wave finally is DC getting the upper hand. But the Eclipse from U9, he wants Resolution, but Moon is taking too much of it. With the Epicenter from KP, the effect is negligible, and KP's on the run with the open wounds. Fire strikes off cooldown, but he still has to run harder than this. He doesn't have maneuverability, he doesn't have mana, he can't even sandstorm to try and hide from them all, because he knows to be brought out of it, and that it is in a triple kill for Resolution, walking around at almost no life.
And that loses him his Blink Dagger gold and gives it to Moon Meander. DC, they have taken full control of this game. I am really surprised how well they, because we knew they were going to be able to take control of the game early, but this is such a dominant start by them. They're almost at 10,000 gold lead already.
That's probably the biggest lead we've seen at this point, apart from maybe the last game of this series. But these drafts were meant to be so much closer. There was so much more for each team to use. There was not one point we said, this is going to be a huge weakness. This is just terrific play coming out from DC. The fact that Moon had such a fantastic start to the offlane as well. Then the rotations caused more issues. And Weeha, he's had the time of his life. He's not going to consider the blink into the kill over on Faith. There's still a little bit too much regeneration from the fight against.
Yeah, because they pushed Newbie so deep into their own side of the map that they're actually pretty naturally grouped up. They've got a lot of close proximity, so they need to be careful. They need to curb this aggression just a tad. One of the big things is that Newbie, it's not like Newbie is going to be able to hit these amazing timings as they go later on to the game either, because DC's lineup is not bad versus Luna. They have in particular one of the best support counters to Luna in Shadow Demon. We saw in that last fight actually, the way that Eclipse was tanked up by the Luna illusion, and Luna actually dropped quite low because of the physical damage coming out from the Shadow Demon illusions, and that just gets worse over time too.
You know, it's a wonderful time when Karka puts down a sentry ward, but he can't see up on the hill. Okay, finally Faith's going to be bringing in the courier. But now they also realize there's an observe ward on the hill. DC was watching all their maneuvering, which was basically four heroes running under an observer ward. And you've got the twitching Moon just looking to explode somebody if he can find somebody. But this is a nice big item as well. The SK now has his Blink Dagger, so KP has that just shy of the 19-minute mark.
It's time for a smoke off of that blink. Newbie, they know they're in a very bad situation, so they need these lanes to push out a little bit. It looks like they're feeling comfortable. Oh, they've got a haste rune in SC's bottle.
This will be huge with his blink, and then with the haste rune positioning, Digital Chaos may not be able to control this fight.
Yeah, and Quant may not, like, even if she does manage to get the blink off here, she may not be able to
save. Oh, the Sonic Wave committed early, all he wanted was farm, but now Weehaw's gonna go down with the Epitetic committed. It's gonna slow down the Shadow Demon. Difficult for him to run away, but the support, it jumps him through the rear. Resolution and Moon teaming up as he's going to do a little bit more work, but he just can't do it. There's no extra speed. He'll go down. Three heroes lost from Newbie, and more stranded away. Four heroes down as U9 falls as well. KP, the sole survivor. And he's on the wrong side of the tracks.
I am getting deja vu of this last game, Toby. Once again, Newbie are trapped inside, more and more trapped on their side of the map. They have to go for this aggressive smoke push out, see if they can gain some control back by a team fight, and it just turns all wrong as DC are able to turn around. They lost their Queen of Pain, but Resolution is the big net worth hero right now. Honestly, Newbie can't even look at the Lifestealer. He's way too damn big. They just have to go for everyone else around on DC and kind of try and kite the Lifestealer as best as possible. One of the really good plays, Soxa, recognizing that haste rune immediately and purging it off, that halted a lot of the momentum.
He is in a very sticky situation. Hulk Stomp in double edge and goodbye! That Sand King is turned to dust. And Digital Chaos, a one man up for 25 more seconds, can push towards the tier 2 towers.
Yeah, I mean, they're Newbie are just feeling like they have to go for these desperate sort of situations. That's why Sand King does something like that. He pushes out this lane super aggressively, thinking, you know, I need to buy my team some space. I need to be able to push this out and dodge this gank and be able to find Luna and Templar Assassin places to be able to farm. But it just naturally has the inherent risk that you're getting caught by the Centaur.
Well, you do have that space for Luna, and DC are willingly giving it to her. But that's because they're also looking towards the top lane. The Infest into Moon. And they look for their target. And where are they going? They actually pop down the bottom lane.
Yeah, this is good.
But it's only good like if they can find U9. And, well, it's good. They found U9. Hooks on forward. Pop it out. And goodbye, Luna. It was meant to be your farm. He buys up as much of the Hurricane Pike as he possibly can.
Man, I was but going to say that rotation up to the top lane, I was like, oh, look at all this space that U9 has, and immediately the Infest Centaur rotation. DC just keeping up the pressure at all times. The only one who is progressing in some farm, though, Radiant's is SC. His Desolator will be a big addition, but
the cost is so much. Like, the cost is so much to get to it. Like,
yeah,
you're using Witch Doctor, Ogre, and SK to all babysit SC so we could farm the Ancients and the two small cans.
And look at, like, Centaur is super tanky at this point in time. He has Hood of Defiance as well as Vanguard. Is about to actually finish up a Crimson. And Lifestealer is still even with the Desolator. Normally, TA is supposed to be able to challenge Lifestealer. I'm not sure if you can, thanks to this early AC pickup.
Yep. So with AC and Crimson, good luck. It's the best way to say it. Even Witch Doctor's like, I got a level 1 with Death Ward. This is gonna basically hit like feathers.
Yeah, I think they actually have to dodge DC and maybe use this Desolator to quickly push out waves and try and challenge some of the outer towers.
But DC's coming to challenge them.
Yeah, they are.
I got money for the blind arrow now from Misery. I say blind, there's still so much vision up from DC. And the 5 seconds done, it connects over on Kanka. They're not close enough to instantly jump in. And a really good position from KP. Actually, no, the Shadow Poison. Out from SD, trying to keep that vision over on the SK, and they're able to do it. That's why the Stampede spawn, commit the Sonic Wave, but the bigger one, Disruption as well. Nubia trying to bail, but it's the Witch Doctor to fall too. Maybe more. U9 and SD are still in the neighborhood. Kaka with the TP, Eclipse will pop off, but Moon will tank the whole enchilada. Does he have enough life to survive? Of course he does. Maybe not with the Paralyzing Cards. Now into the Death Ward. The damage is finally being done by Nubia, but is it too little too late?
They're going to be able to get this extra kill. It's the support, just the cherry on top. The buyback does barely manage to save that fight for them, but Newbie are going to still be disappointed. They really wanted to keep the Luna alive, turn that into a Roshan attempt. It looks like without the Luna, they're still going to go for it.
And this is kind of like Newbie, no. The arrow will fly in. It'll connect over on Kaka. It's better him than SC at this point.
They have Sonic Wave too.
Have a bit of a look. Resolution will run in. They want to try and focus him. A great Burrow Strike catching out both Piranha as well as we will jump in. And Misery actually caught up on the hillside. TA will give some extra vision with that trap, allowing SC to find that last little pop. But now he's also being chased down. Resolution commits the ulti. SC trying to hide.
What?
With the Epicenter. He he's able to get a couple. You've still got Roshan up. Templar Assassin has buyback. Is it going to be worth it to finish the job?
I'll take your tribute.
No, I think they definitely got to be just... they have to sit back on this one. They don't have the Eclipse on the Luna. Just because she's alive doesn't all of a sudden grant you strength to be able to contest this. So, unfortunately, if only the buybacks could have kept the Luna alive.
Oh, no. Urgot, clap yourself to freedom.
Oh, boy.
SD Disrupt will make this difficult. The Paralyzing Cask is still going to fly out, but now it's Fate. He came in to help his teammate, and all he'll end up doing is dying. The Coconut isn't that strong, so he'll fall. And Digital Chaos pick up an extra two, and you know what KP wants to do.
I mean,
he's looking for it. He is looking for it. With the TA trap, he's got the information to do it. There's no Dire Observer Ward to watch this. Potentially, SK could do this. Roshan down to 300, 100, jump in. Dire got Roshan. Aegis the Immortal, no resolution. No. Got it. KP goes stunned. The arrow will fly forward. KP is so low. Weeha blinked on cooldown, but it won't matter. Centaur, the axe is long enough. It can still cleave KP and Twine.
KP was trying to go for the ultra, ultra move. Blink in, be able to grab the Aegis and Burrow Strike his way out of there instead of just going for the sacrificial. Burrow, steal the Aegis, and die twice in a row. I agree with that, though. He has to make these extraordinary plays to be able to give Newbie a chance, because now DC are in full form to be able to take the rest of your tier 2s as well as the shrines, and we've heard this story time and time again at this tournament, Toby. In 7.0, as if this happens by, you know, before the 30-minute marker, it's just so likely you've lost the game because there's so much map control flowing into the way of DC. They have all this extra, like, tower bounty, they have all this map control to be able to work around with, and Newbie, they have the cores that still need a lot of build-up, and they're just not going to be able to have the space to find it.
It's going to take a miracle or a throw. That's basically what we're looking at right now. And if they can create as much space they possibly can, at least Luna is finding her farm on the other side of the map. It's the safest place to be, which is the Dire side of the jungle, where DC don't want to be. They took out the tier 2 tower. Here goes your first shrine. And more items are going to start to flow in. Everyone's rolling in the money. That courier from the Dire side flying out, it's got Desolator, 4-star, extra 1k items, a gem of True Sight. It's more loaded than the Urga Magi.
Una Enfield so uncomfortable with the pressure that he felt earlier from Moon Meander Resolution that he didn't even really want to show himself too much in that bottom lane. He just was kind of taking the jungle. He's even right now using the Alpha Wolf to be able to push down the tier 1 tower because he can't risk his hero being caught.
Yep. He's almost managed to get it too, Moon. Oh, Battle of the Denial. The other shrine's going down, so the Battle of the Alpha Wolf is probably more the interesting thing. He's forced into a corner and actually... Oh, he did actually get it.
So got the deny.
Bail out and KP go deeper into the trees. DP away to safety, and Digital Chaos now push out the bottom lane to get momentum back. But SC, he's doing a good job up to the top lane, getting closer and closer towards that Hurricane Pike. Having the 4-star early on at least allows him to deal with the open wounds and all the slow positioning that keeps coming out from DC.
Yeah, I was going to talk about, you know, oh, there's this upside of Luna being able to get the level 3 ultimate here in a little bit, but at the same time, Moon Meander's about to complete the pipe. That'll obviously mitigate the upgrade and damage pretty heavily, so. And they also love the early gem pickup as well.
Nice. Resolution popping that rage as KP tried to go for the Blink Forest Strike. Just try and delay them up and give more SC more time to attack up on top, but it didn't work, so SC has to come down to the bottom lane to defend. He just has no other choice. The creep wave will still take out the tier 1 tower on top lane. So that's one advantage. The arrow, nice 4-star, pushing him away from the arrow, away from the initiation. With a Maledict over on Moon, they commit in the Death Ward. Moon's taking some heavy damage here. That is a level 4 Maledict, but they hide under the cover of Moonlight Shadow.
I like that early choice by Resolution to pop out. He recognized instantly that Moon Meander was in trouble and he had to push back the heroes of Newbie in order to make sure that Moon Meander survived. Just like, you know, if they get like two or three more nukes in, maybe a big hit by the Templar Assassin, he may drop out.
Resolution jumped in. There's not many friends nearby for him. Obviously, he's got the Aegis, maybe trying to soak up the Eclipse of Unite.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
But this is now becoming a siege situation from DC.
I love all the mobility choices that Newbie have made. They need to kite Resolution. So they've got this four staff on the Ogre as well as the Sand King, and then double Hurricane Pipes for Templar Assassin and Luna.
You called them the kings of the high ground defense. With them,
I mean, they'll be gods of the high. They'll be gods of the high ground defense if they can survive through this like 10-minute window where Digital Chaos are currently sitting on 20,000 gold and 15,000 experience.
Man, they're just gonna turn this entire thing into just like full staff somebody in, then Hurricane Pike them in even deeper, then Hurricane the Pipe even deeper than that, just to get them under the tier 4 towers. You almost start fountain hooking with all these four staffs.
Newbie. Have to stay constantly grouped up, which does mean the Templar Assassin or the Luna are going to start suffering in farm because of it. I think U9 is the more important here when it comes to farm, because if he gets his Manta, they have ways to be able to split push better with less risk. That way you just throw illusions down lanes, and obviously there's no inherent risk to that one.
Still got a little bit to go, and he's like, obviously with the buybacks, you're thinking about saving money, but it's the mana, it's not a recipe. Maybe they also understand that if you have to buy back on the Luna, you're probably losing this game. He needs to have those bigger items.
Yeah, absolutely. The time for buybacks is kind of over. If you get stalled up in your progression and items now, I don't think there's much coming back into it. I mean, look at Resolution. This guy's shopping for a heart right now. He's got 3,000 gold, and he's thinking, yeah, I've got this AC. You know what would really make me unkillable? Just this gigantic raw increase in AC.
He just switched. He just switched over to the Bachelor. Okay, the second right. You said that, it would make him unkillable.
I was like, man, that is something else. I think Resolution was toying with the idea of like, oh, maybe I'll just be like this frontliner that bangs on the tier 3 towers, and because of the heart, I'm so tanky they can't go on me. But I think it's much better to go for the Basher. He's got this vehicle in Moon Meander who's tanky enough. If they can actually close the distance.
Oh, here they come, Newbie. They need a really good initiation. What are they going to find? They're going to find a sandwich. Well, the Forest Strike. The Rage is already up from Limesteel. They push down, but burn! A huge stun! That could be it. They've lost so much. It was the last roll of the dice. They jump forward, but there's two heroes on the retreat.
GG!
Digital Chaos in style, in convincing fashion, have taken the last two games, and this will give them a 3-2 victory over Newbie.
Remember game 3, Toby? Remember what Digital Chaos they looked like? This is a team that cannot be mentally broken, man. They came back hard in game 4 and 5 and closed out this series in